A little over 100 miles south of Fairbanks is a train stop called Healy. It's a quiet little place full of friendly people. But the surrounding area is much more, a study of contrasts, of massive machinery and power plants, and buffalo herds. Modern clinics. And highway truck stops. There's an active social life, the way small town America is supposed to be. And practically no unemployment. It's an area of raw natural beauty. And a place where, for no apparent reason, the hills are burning. Just before you reach Denali National Park, traveling south from Fairbanks, there's a turnoff to Healy. If you follow this winding road back into the mountains, it will lead you to the entrance to the Usibelli Coal Mines. The road sign is not a quaint English custom. If you fail to observe it, you may meet head-on with one of these roaring giants. The left-hand drive rule is for their benefit. It gives the driver a clear view of the shoulder of the road. Driving too close could mean a fatal accident. And this is the valuable cargo of the trucks. Coal, the lifeblood not only of the Healy area, but the entire interior of Alaska. Coal mining here bears little resemblance to images of miners working in dark underground shafts. This is open pit mining. It requires heavy machinery. The process is straightforward enough. First, the overburden or top layer of ground is cleared away down to each layer or seam of coal. Coal, which is then quite simply scooped up and hauled away. As soon as one truck is full, another is waiting for its turn. Once a seam has been mined, the land is reclaimed. Though there are other coal-rich areas in Alaska, the Usibelli operation is the only active coal mining in the state. So the process continues from dawn to dusk, 5 days a week, 52 weeks a year. These mountains are abundant with coal deposits. Over 800,000 tons are removed each year. Even with anticipated increases, there is enough coal in just this area, known as Poker Flats, to keep the miners busy for the next 20 years. Once loaded, the trucks move quickly to deposit their load. Usually into this coal loader called a tipple. It crushes the coal to a common size and sends it across the river to a storage area by conveyor belt. Beneath the storage area is a convenient tunnel for trains. Every morning, Monday through Friday, a trainload of coal is loaded and sent on its way. It may end up at the Fairbanks Municipal Utilities System, or the University of Alaska Fairbanks, or Fort Wainwright, or Eielson Air Force Base, or Clear Air Force Station, or Golden Valley Electric Association, including GVEA's newest power plant in the Healy area. In short, coal from the Usibelli mine is the main source of energy for the interior, just as this boiler room is the main source of heat for the entire mining operation. Directly or indirectly, the coal keeps us warm, provides us with electricity, and generally makes life more bearable. The mine is the major employer in the Healy area and is a totally self-sufficient operation. It maintains a 90-day supply of parts. And keeps track of everything by computer. The Usibelli mine has been going since 1943, but there has been coal mining activity in the area since 1909. This is a ghost of one of those former mines. Back then, coal was transported across the river, a bucket at a time. In earlier days, each mining operation maintained its own community for miners and families. For years, the valley was dotted with such company-owned towns. Today, most workers live in subdivisions away from the mine. A few people still live in what was once the mining town of Suntrana. The coal loader, or tipple here, is still in use. Suntrana is an Indian word which translates as hills of fire or the burning hills, and with good reason. The hills by Suntrana are on fire. The smoke is plainly visible, and at times flames even appear. Back in the 30s, an underground mine collapsed. A fire started in the mine shaft, and it burns to this day. Transportation is the crucial link in getting the coal from the ground to the customer. If the coal is the lifeblood of the area, the railroad is the arteries and veins. The actual town of Healy is for, by, and of the railroad. Everyone who lives there is in some way associated with the Alaska Railroad. Healy is a regular stop on the route, and passengers can get on or off the train there. It is also the changeover point for railroad crews. The Healy Hotel, close to the public, provides rooms and a restaurant for the crews stopping over. Housing is provided at a low rent for permanent railroad employees and their families. There's even a post office which serves the greater Healy area. Louise Grys is the postmaster.
I am John Grys, section foreman of Alaska Railroad in Healy. I've been here for 27 years. That's me.
That's you.
How are you? Your turn.
I'm Louise Grys. And I came up from Wisconsin in
58.
I've been here ever since then. I'm the postmaster in Healy.
I had a friend, and our dream was to come to Alaska. That was the place to go, to dig gold and hunt moose and catch wolves and that kind of life. But it didn't turn out quite that way. I found out you have to work for a living, or I had to work for wages and do the other things as a hobby.
When we had our girls, all three of them were born here when there was no road. And as far as medical problems, you've had medical problems. Kids do get sick. And it was all home remedies. And of course, you had to find a nice doctor in town that knew you, and he'd send medicine down for you that you could have it on a shelf. And I had Dr. Dunlap as a doctor then, and he'd always send me some penicillin that you mixed with water. I always had 3-4 bottles on a shelf. But I do have to say, when the girls were sick in the middle of the night, I used to sit and hold them, and I'd ask myself, what in the heck am I doing here? If I lived in Wisconsin, and even out in the farm, this baby would be in the hospital. There was times, especially when you take a temperature and it's got 105 fever, there's no way. Tell them what we did.
Give them a bath. Bring the body temperature down in the bathtub. The kids loved to go swimming in a bathtub, and this automatically lowered their body temperature, or the fever disappeared.
But you had to keep them cool and keep on giving them these baths.
One of the major changes John and Louise remember in Healy was the construction of the highway connecting them with Fairbanks and Anchorage.
With the road coming through, my husband lost his hobby. Trapping.
Oh, yeah. We were no longer isolated, and people drifted in. The world's greatest trappers all migrated to Healy, and I got froze out.
And he's not one that he's going to go out and camp overnight. He likes his bed.
Well, that's what you asked, how things change. Oh, that's one little thing. But everybody bought cars, and we can drive into Nenana or Fairbanks for groceries.
And that forced us to buy a new car, too, when we got a road in Healy. Otherwise, we only had a piece of junk. When you took me off to the airstrip over there to make that charter flight out of Healy, you almost couldn't start the car.
What'd you have to charter out for?
Because I was going to have a baby.
You chartered a plane out?
Sure, midnight. There was a second daughter. He went for a ride, and he come home, and he found me in labor, and he had to get a plane out of here at midnight. And he couldn't start the old junk. Planes buzzing around Healy.
Did you make it in time?
Oh, yeah. lots of things. Yeah. And I checked in at 1 o'clock. She was born at 3:30. Lots of time.
Every so often people come up with wild ideas about how Healy is going to grow.
Or either fade away.
It won't fade away. I picked a town that will not fade away.
When you talk of Healy, there is the town itself, and there is the greater Healy area, which is growing at a steady rate. The Golden Valley Power Plant brought a new influx of residents. There may not be many homes in this subdivision now, but the streets are laid out for future families. There is a school, which means more permanent residents with teachers and their families.
And press the return key, and that would get you that program.
The school provides a focus of community activity, like this computer class for adults held on Saturday.
Okay, all I need to do is press the backspace key. I notice the one is still on the screen, but I just put in the new number, and it takes care of that.
Later that night, there was a more traditional school activity, a Valentine's Day dance. Across town that same evening, there was a sweetheart banquet taking place in the multi-purpose room of the newest addition to Healy, a community center. One of the most important occupants of the center is the Healy Clinic, providing medical care to the area. It is fully equipped and supplied, and it's run by physician's assistant John Winklmann. John's wife, Pat, helps out at the reception desk.
We're set up for and capable of handling most routine medical problems here. That we run the office just like, for instance, what you would see in a general practitioner's office. I work under the indirect supervision of a physician in Fairbanks, and we're in communication by phone or radio. Anytime that I or we or he desires that, it's a matter of I only have to pick up the phone and make one phone call, and I can have anywhere from 5 to 15 emergency medical technicians, for instance, here to help with a major medical problem or injury, and that's all done on a voluntary basis. Just about everything that you see around here has been done with a lot of voluntary effort. When we first came here, we had it in the back of our minds to move on to somewhere else. I think the big change came when we moved into a little log cabin in the woods and developed that into a pretty comfortable little home. It's like overnight that we just looked around and said, this is a really nice place. There's nice folks here. There's other kids growing up, and we were beginning, we planned on a family at that time. So I think this is where we're going to be. This is where we're going to live. When we take a vacation, our best vacations occur when we stay at home in Healy here.
Healy has a very stable economy. It has the coal mine, the railroad, the power plant, then we have our school. Basically, 98% of all the people that live here in the valley are employed year-round. It's a good, stable economy, and there's approximately 600 living here in the valley now. Everybody knows everybody else. Somebody gets into a bind, people are there to help them out. It's not like in the cities, you can live next door to your neighbor for 10 years and don't even know their first name. But the people who live in this area are more like the people who came to Alaska years ago. They're more the doers, not the receivers. They're here to build, not to take. And this is what I like about the area.
About 5 miles north of Jerry's Healy service is the Mercer Ranch. It's the kind of place you see on postcards. Berle Mercer's latest project is a herd of bison.
I'm Berle Mercer, living at Healy, just north of Healy, about 5 miles, really at Lignite. And we've got a livestock ranch, a small one, with buffalo and horses and cows, and did some packing and guiding, and the greatest thing is raising a family here.
I'm his wife, Claire, and we have 6 children. Practically all of them are grown now. Our youngest is senior in high school. And I work at the school as school secretary. We really enjoyed the old days. You have your family as a compact unit. You're sufficient to yourself. Not that we didn't like people. We liked going and visiting with people in Healy and having them come here. But it was a very satisfying life, I think.
Well, I don't know. I think that was really one of the thrilling things about being here. You felt like you were in the wilderness, kind of. But we had the standard regular bamboo hoops that used on many railroads. You know, if we had mail put onto the train, you hook that onto the hoop, and then the bagman sticks his arm out the window and catch the hoop, take the mail off. At the same time, kick your mail out the door or throw it out. Then you may walk down the tracks a quarter, half mile, pick up the hoop to retrieve it and to have it for the next time. And if you have bags too big put on the train at that time, you'd flag the train down, they'd stop and they'd take it. And if you didn't have enough postage, they notified you by a note on the next train through. And sometime or the other, you eventually got them enough money to make up for it. And if you wanted to go on the train, you just flagged it down, you get on, and that's where we'd go to town. At that time, it was really nice. We'd get on the train down here at 5 o'clock in the morning, flag it down, and get in Fairbanks a little after 8, shop all day in Fairbanks, get on the train at 8 at night, get back home at midnight, and no worries at all. You can sit and visit, you can sleep or anything else. It wasn't like driving a car to town and worrying about flat tires or skidding off the road or the snow blowing from trucks where you couldn't see where you was going. That's somebody else's problem.
And I liked it.
If I could make my choice again, if there's some way I could change things, that's where we would be back to that style now.
Is it getting a little too crowded around here, too many people?
Well, in a lot of ways, plus I just feel a lot of unnecessary expense. It just seems like people can't be satisfied with what they've got to spend. First it's going to be a small road, then it's a bigger road, and then it's more all the time, which I think we could just keep doing things to do things rather than out of whether it's necessary or not, or whether it's serving a legitimate purpose.
Well, for water, we were just taking our bucket down to this creek out here and getting it. And we did that up until 1977. For power, we started with the old Aladdin lanterns and worked our way up to the Coleman lamps, and then we had some propane lights, and then we had our own power plants, and then finally Golden Valley.
It looked like to me it was a place where a person could really do anything they wanted to and anybody would accept it. It wasn't like where I grew up at, that you did what your father did, your brothers did, your uncles and your grandparents. or you were ostracized. It looked like to me as something you could try anything new that you wanted to or do it, and you were accepted. And that's what I was interested in, trying something different. I wanted to be in agriculture and raise livestock, but I wanted to try some ideas and do something different. There was no challenge to me with what was going on back there.
You feel pretty much like you've been able to do that up here?
Yeah, except there is one thing, as Claire said, it was very difficult not having anybody discuss your problems with. We want to do our own thing, but it sure been nice to have somebody to talk over ideas with and share experiences with.
Like all of Alaska, Healy is a changing, growing area. But unlike the rest of the state, that growth is gradual and measured. There is no boom and bust cycle here. For the most part, the people are happy, contented, and serene, like the mountains that surround them.